So the farmers will tell you that accessing quality seeds on the market is a challenge. Of course, this is because there are lots of substandard seeds that have been flocking the markets and, of course, hampering their success in the agricultural sector. But UNBS will tell you they are trying to do all it takes to ensure that they avail seeds. But we'll be telling you about Kakasa as the show goes by. A very good evening and thank you very much for joining us on Money Talk this week. My name is Simon Okitela and we are here at the Sheraton Kampala Hotel, taking a look at what's making headlines in the world of business. But first, let's take a look at what you can expect on the show tonight. Coming up on the show, we take a look at Barclays Bank and will it leave or not? What does this mean to the customers?
The central bank has come out to clarify that Barclays Bank Uganda is a locally incorporated bank. While it is part of a global business of Barclays, Barclays Uganda has to conform to laws that are particular to Uganda.
Also on the show, Kakasa app launched to help farmers determine which seeds are fake as they buy them. And in this week's Personal Finance, we give you tips on how to buy insurance policies and just how they could save your business in case of any fires. This and more coming up in just a bit. Welcome to the show, and this week we'll start with the insurance industry. And the regulator says the mergers could be the next big thing for the industry, of course, as they seek to ensure that they grow the industry and also move away from the low penetration of 0.85%. Now, their development in the industry is a switch from compliance-based insurance to risk-based insurance, which means that supervision by the regulator will be focusing more on the companies that have more business in the industry. Take a look.
According to IRA, insurance companies will in financial year 2016-17 start implementing risk-based supervision over compliance supervision to offer confidence to insurance policy takers.
What we have been doing before was called compliance-based supervision. And with the compliance-based supervision, it's almost ticking a box. Do you have this? I tick. Do you have that? I tick. Do you have that? I tick. But with the risk-based supervision, the onus is taken back to the insurance companies. You have to examine the systems yourself.
Ibrahim Kadnab Lubega, the chief executive officer, says under risk-based supervision, players will ensure they will avail quality data policies and systems for underwriting premiums with a push from the regulator as it was under the compliance supervision. This is expected to promote transparency amongst the insurance players, thus encouraging growth plus penetration.
We agreed that we shall move to caramel and then from caramel to the fully blown risk-based supervision. The intention was to comply with the best practices.
It will also ensure sufficient capital is maintained by insurers to meet risks and also provide the IRA with more time to supervise risk firms. Levels of debt liabilities, inflation, and monetary policy will also be required to compute insurers' risk under the new regime and will strengthen the domestic insurance sector. Meanwhile, the regulator says more insurance companies will merge in 2016 as already established companies are buying struggling ones.
Mergers world over is an in thing. So when companies merge, it shouldn't be seen as if they are bad or they are weak. No, the world over, companies merge. And we are yet to see more mergers, even in 2016. As I mentioned earlier on, there are some companies which are already in discussion of merging.
Risk-based supervision is a structured process aimed at identifying the most critical risks that face each company, which would enable the industry supervisor to assess the company's management of those risks and the company's financial viability to potential adverse experience. Risk-based supervision would also provide supervisors with appropriate tools to assess the overall solvency of the insurers and encourage insurance companies to better measure and manage their risks.
welcome to the show, Samuel.
Thank you.
Have you been?
Same.
That story, what do you make of it?
Well, it was largely expected due to falling global commodity prices, which have affected our incomes from our exports, like coffee, tea. There's been price declines. The GDP is a combination of the difference between what we earn from exports and what we spend on imports, as well as government expenditure and consumption expenditure, among other things, are what is what is added to get the GDP. Now, as it is, the prices of coffee and tea, as I've said, have been struggling on the global markets. At the same time, we have issues with the exchange rate. It's more expensive to import. So you already have a negative over there. And then the central bank did say that they had revised down, actually the Minister of Finance, which was at the central bank recently, did say that they're having issues.
Okay, so lots of developments in the market, and you just hit it on one of them. The shilling seems to have gained for a few months now against the dollar. What do you think is behind that?
The traders from commercial banks say that the shilling is actually gaining because of muted activity. You find that the players in the economy, the people that actually import a lot, have stayed action as they watch the economy following the election. We've had an election, we've just completed that in February. It's now March.
Let's talk about what could have caused a lot of tension in the market. And Barclays Bank probably not going anywhere, but looks like people don't understand what's happening. What exactly is happening?
The central bank has come out to clarify that Barclays Bank Uganda is a locally incorporated bank. While it is part of a global business of Barclays, Barclays Uganda has to conform to laws that are particular to Uganda, meaning they have to have a particular amount of capital, they have to perform in a particular way, and the central bank has said that they are okay, they are stable. It does not have a direct impact right now. However, that will depend on the new player that will buy the shares that Barclays UK will sell. It's possible that we could have a change in name of the bank. It's very possible. However, Barclays UK has said they intend to retain a small stake under South Africa for some time now. Yes. So this exit of Barclays UK from Barclays Africa, no, it does not have a direct impact right now. However, that will depend on the new player.
Will the customers still stay in the bank if probably the name changes? As we wind up, Sam, really, what's your final take on the growth in the country right now? The
government says they are going to maintain the expenditure on infrastructure. That is not going to change. Uganda's economy has benefited so much from government's strategic investment in infrastructure. And so that's not going to change. The economy will continue to do well and grow. Perhaps the only concern would be private sector-led growth, which maybe has not been as strong. Okay. However, with the end of the election cycle, we do anticipate that all will go well and we will have higher private sector activity, and hopefully inflation will begin to stabilize, loan rates will begin to reduce, and all will be well.
Well, Director Dieter Ige Africa, I must say, thank you very much for joining us on the show. All the best. Well, I've been speaking to Samuel Sanya. They are trying to put out a few issues about the economy, and of course, looks like it's positive. It will now suddenly pick up, given that the election year is actually done, and business could get back to, you know, the usual ups and downs. But yes, the profits will certainly be coming through. We'll now take a very short break. When I return, we'll be talking Kakasa up. or an application that could change the way the agriculture sector performs, as it will help farmers detect fake seeds and fake drugs. We'll be right back.